In this video, I'll be taking you through my journey from making buttons by hand to making my own UI library in C++. Now, I learned a lot of useful stuff along the way, and I want you to also learn this stuff. So we will talk about the things used in the industry, and go through the entire design process of a system like this. So hopefully, you improve your programming thinking and design less over-engineered and better systems. UI is a difficult topic in programming, and this is proven by the fact that there are many frameworks and ways of doing UI. And I think I know why it is so difficult, but I want you to also figure it out yourself. Don't worry, I'll give you hints throughout the video, and I'll tell you the reason if you don't figure it out. But now, let's dive into our UI journey. So imagine you have to design some sort of UI library that would allow the user to create buttons and layouts. How would you do it if you didn't know about other existing UI frameworks? Really, take some time to think about it, because I'll return to your answer later. You can even write it in the comment section if you want. Now, the first thing that might come to mind is to make some sort of visual editor where you could put buttons and later access them through code. This is how Windows Forms work. However, you don't usually see something like this in web development. And we should probably look there, because it's very UI intensive. So they probably realized that having a visual editor is not a good solution. Why is that? Well, the first reason, and it is more of a personal note, is that after you add buttons, you have to add some functionality to them on click, and you usually do that using callbacks. I don't like callbacks because, while they are very simple to use, you just assign a function to a button somewhere, you make it harder to debug because, for one, they could theoretically happen in any order, and you can't take a good look at the logic. But web development also uses callbacks, so there is another bigger reason why UI editors are not used. And it is because it is less easy to make them dynamic. Imagine adding an entire new element or something. How would you do that? A UI editor is good for designing an UI, but what if you have to add stuff programmatically? This is why the web uses code to create its UI. HTML is used to describe the content, and CSS is used to describe how it is aligned. This makes it easy to add stuff, but a lot more tedious when making the layout. So this is why there are UI libraries like Bootstrap. It allows the user to more easily make a layout at the expense of some flexibility. But that is okay because websites usually have similar layouts anyway. In my case, in game development, layouts are usually very simple, and for debug stuff, you don't even care about how it looks. You just want to write it fast. For example, there is something called Immediate Mode UI, and I'll explain how it works in a second, but first, take a look here. The first takeaway from this video is a quote by Mike Acton. Different data requires a different solution. So if you want flexibility, we can use something like CSS, which is tedious to work with. For something later more specific, we can use Bootstrap, which removes some of the complexity but also some flexibility. Or at the other end of the spectrum, we can have something very simple, but that is not very flexible in terms of design. So remember the question that I asked you earlier about designing a UI library? Do you have your answer? Well, it is probably wrong. The correct answer should have been the question, what kind of UI layout does the user need? Usually, programmers like to make general solutions that work in any possible case to save time in the future. The problem here is that most of the time, you only need one special case and never need anything else in the future. So you end up spending a lot of time making that system. And a system that is good at anything is not the best at a particular thing in general. Trust me, you are at least sacrificing how easy the system is to use by adding more flexibility. Now, I'm not saying to never over-engineer your code, but before you start making a complicated system, ask yourself these questions. Do I really need that much flexibility? Will I really take the time to reuse this system and do that cool thing that I'm thinking about right now? What is the specific problem that I need to solve? Now, back to UI. Immediate Mode UI just means that you can, in a very descriptive way, say what UI element you want. Think of it like HTML without CSS. Let me show you IMGUI, which is a great UI library. Here I'm telling IMGUI that I want a window with some text, a slider, and a button. The coolest thing is the fact that I don't pass any callbacks, but rather, I just check if the button was clicked with an if, and the slider will write the value back into a variable. This makes the code very easy to read and debug. And this little bit of code generates a full UI layout with windows that are even dockable. And it can even be controlled by a controller. How cool is that? Now, IMGUI will basically place the elements in order, and it is okay because for making a debugging window, we don't care about the layout that much. You can, however, use MGUI for more complex stuff if you want to, like I did in my engine. Okay, now let's finally start to design a UI library. So what was the first thing that I told you to do before designing a system? Exactly. Ask yourself, what you need to actually do. Let's say that you want to be able to play some simple visual elements in your game, like you can see here in my Steam game, but you also want them to be responsive. Well, for this, I made my very simple UI tool, and it looks like this. First of all, I have a frame, and that is just the working space of the library. Then, I can create a box. Whenever I use percentage stuff, it will refer to its frame parent. And I can easily change the description of my UI elements and create subparents. If you're wondering how these things work, well, for the frame I basically write to some global variables in the constructor and reset them in the destructor. And to create this chain of methods, I just return a reference to the current object at the end of every method call. If you want to see more C++ tricks like this, I have a video on that. This tool is very simple because I wanted to solve the very simple problem of placing some responsive UI elements on the screen. It is not good enough for the game menu. So I made another system. Again. What do I want? Well, I want some buttons in a vertical layout. I want to be able to control them both with the mouse and the controller, and I want them to be responsive. And that's it. So I designed it like this. You simply tell the system what buttons you want in order, and after that, it will take all of them and calculate their position. There is one selected button, and the system will also change it if you start pressing the up or down buttons on the controller. Now, this worked well, but it has two limitations. The first is the fact that I don't handle submenus. And this is very bad because they turn out to be a pain to implement. And the code ended up being very ugly. I also can't change the layout. So this is when I made my first proper UI library. It is called GLUI, and this is the thing that I also used when making my Terraria clone. So by now you probably already know the drill. What problem am I trying to solve? Well, I want to be able to place some elements in any layout that I want while keeping them responsive. I wanted to handle submenus, and most importantly, I want it to be very easy to code, because I was tired of writing UI code, and sometimes you just want to be able to add a quick dirty menu to test your stuff. So my UI library works by adding cells to a column. You can also have multiple columns. The most important thing is that the elements know of one another and are always placed evenly apart. Now, to make it easy to use, I took inspiration from MGUI. You can just type if button and you can write the button's behavior there. Submenus is the thing that I am most proud of. You just type begin menu and end menu, and whatever is inside the call will be a submenu. The library will add a button for you to go there, and it will handle all the logic for you. If you want to reuse a menu, you can just put that into a function. So, check my callbacks. One last thing about this library is that it even provides a basic button model if you don't provide a texture, so you can easily do some quick menus to test your game. But it also allows you to add a custom element, so technically, you can implement any UI with this library. It works by adding an empty element, and it gives you the information that you need, like the position, size, and mouse events. Okay, now there is one more problem with this library, and it is that the UI is kind of ugly. And it is okay because I didn't care about how it looked, but for my future games, I will definitely need something to look better. So you know the drill. Actually, before you do that, did you figure out why UI is so difficult to implement? Well, I think it is because it is a very visual problem. And unlike 3D games, which are actually a very numerical problem, UI is something visual. You want it to look good no matter the screen dimensions. And like I described earlier, you want it to be controlled by code to have flexibility. So the glue between the UI and our code is some sort of descriptive language that can be CSS, a library like MGUI, or a UI editor that provides some interface in the code. Now, with that in mind, what do I want to do now? Well, I want a UI library that is responsive, looks good, and is easy to use. Well, the second takeaway from this video is the fact that when you can't sacrifice anything in a system, like flexibility, or maybe ease of use, it is very hard to choose how to design it. Put your philosophical head for a little while, because this is interesting. So let's say there are three things that your system can be: easy to use, versatile, and optimized. And imagine that all the infinite possible solutions sit somewhere on this disk. These circles here represent the three aspects: ease of use, versatility, and how optimized it is. The closer a solution is to one of these circles, the better it is in that area. The first thing you can see here is that you can have a solution that is very good on all of these aspects, but you can have a solution that is extremely good in only one area. IMGUI, for example, sits here. It is very easy to use, but not that versatile. The problem is that when you start writing a system, you can't see where these circles are. Or more like, you can only see one at a time. So what most people do is pick a solution design and start working on it. Can you see what happened? The solution was actually good for only two of the criteria that we wanted. Now the thing is that while you develop your solution, you start seeing where a better solution is. So what does that mean? It means that whenever you want to design something very difficult and have many things that you want from it, you should expect to experiment and not have a finished design from the beginning. And most things that are interesting to implement are actually like this. So this is my final UI library, and it is not finished because I want to first test it with a game and modify it depending on what I like and what I don't like about it while using it. It is called Sushi, not because I like it or because it looks like a layout, though it kinda does, but because my game engine, Pika, was named after a cat, so this UI library that will be part of Pika is also named after a cat called Sushi. Now that people have told me that Pika means in Portuguese, I hope that Sushi doesn't also mean anything stupid. Anyway, the basic idea is this. I got inspiration from my last UI library with the cells, but now you have an editor so you can add elements. Elements can have children, and they can be placed anywhere or using a layout rule. Layout rules will also allow me to easily do dynamic layouts in the future that are controlled by code. Now each element is anchored to its parent, and it can be moved by pixels and by parent percentage, so the layout is responsive. I have to add a few more special rules, and this should be enough to achieve any layout that I want. The result can be saved and loaded by the game. Saving is done binary, and the process is interesting, but I'll talk about it in another video about saving data. Subscribe if you don't want to miss that out. Things like buttons are not yet implemented, but I have two interesting ideas. The first one is to report back the inputs after the UI engine finished displaying stuff, so I would use a totally different system to update them. This would allow me to change globally how buttons behave, but I don't really need that. So probably, I'll use a data-oriented design, where each element will have various flags that, when combined, can create all types of behaviors. I will also keep all the rendering logic as some separate and independent functions, so the user can implement some custom widgets if they need. My goal with this UI engine is to be good enough so I can use it in my Minecraft clone. So subscribe if you don't want to miss that out. Until then, why don't you check out my Minecraft clone video if you found this one interesting. See you there!